Hey guys, welcome to Dead House. Let's check out this video called, it's a new epic history TV series, man, let's go! Okay, it's called Alexander the Great, okay? I always wanted to react to this because I heard the name Alexander, Alexander the Great, to be specific. I've heard that name throughout all my life, okay? But I never knew what kind of person he is, what did he achieve, all of that, okay, and what kind of influence he has and everything. I heard the name, but I don't think there's any movies out there either, so that I can watch and learn, you know. But let's just watch this new series. There's, in this series, in this playlist, it's like a bunch of stuff, but, you know, I'm gonna start with the part one, okay, and then I'm gonna continue with other videos, because I don't know about the other ones. The greatest speech in history is another video here that I don't know what to say. And sorry for the lack of uploads. I only upload once a week. I promised in the previous uploads that I'm going to be uploading every day, because I said that because my backup channel's copyright strike was over. Okay, and now I was free to upload. But then 2 days later, after I made the announcements and you know, uploaded my videos and shit, you know, the copyright strike came back for another video. And it's like YouTube was waiting to give me another copyright strike. And it's like, I don't even want to react anymore. You know, I'm only back because, you know, I'm only doing these reactions because, you know, fucking Death Battle video is gonna come out tonight, and I'm gonna have to make a reaction mashup for that. And the Meat Cannon video is already out there, and I have to make a reaction mashup for that as well. You know, so it's a shitload of work, and now I gotta do reactions so that I can include my reactions in it. You know, so it's all a fucking mess. But let's just get into this part one of Alexander the Great by Epic History TV. Okay, it's a new series, it's gonna be cool, and it's gonna be fun. Okay, let's do it. 3, 2, 1. Let's go. And also, like, it's only 16 minutes long, so it's a pretty cool video, okay? But, let's go. 3, 2, 1. Let's get into it, okay? My cat is here. I hope she doesn't annoy me. Fuck. But, let's go. Let's go. 3, 2, 1. Let's go. And I'm sorry if I don't upload that frequently and just stop uploading altogether at some point or whatever. Please try to understand. I'm just tired of, because the YouTube just keeps giving me copyright strike, and YouTube is such a piece of shit, and I don't know what to do. But let's just get into it, okay? 3, 2, 1, let's go.
In 334 BC, Alexander, king of Macedonia, began one of the greatest military campaigns in history against the superpower of the age, the Persian Empire.
Dang.
Just 20 years old, his brilliant and fearless leadership won him back.
20 years old is so young. He's just basically a kid. What the fuck? 20 years old is like, you just became an adult and you don't know shit. Still, you don't know shit. You know, you're just a kid, man. At 20 years old, you have to be like 26 years old or 27 to truly understand the world, you know, to some extent, and then you can grow from there and become an actual responsible, you know, observable adult. You know, before 26 years of age, you're like just some random idiot, just some random kid. It just go steady. You know, you're still educating yourself in the schools and colleges. You don't know anything. Okay, you're just more into what you feel like and what you want to do, and not into how the world is and how you should be looking at yourself and all that. Okay, so at 20 years old, this motherfucker was winning battles. Holy shit, this is insane. Okay, but looks amazing already. Also, we I reacted to other stuff like Belisarius series, and there's other stuff, you know, epic castles and Vikings, five greatest Viking deaths and all of that. Pretty cool stuff. I love all that shit, especially the castles shit. I loved it, okay? And also, like, I'm reacting to the Justinian series to the side. So that's another thing. Cool shit, okay? But let's just watch this, okay? Let's just continue this. And there's a lot of reactions that I gotta do and also make a mashup. So let's watch it.
Battle after battle. And in an astonishing 10-year campaign that took him to the edge of the known world, he carved out one of the largest empires ever known. Few men have had such a massive impact on the course of history. To the Persians, he was Alexander the Accursed. But to the West, he was immortalized as Alexander the Great.
Cool. Fantastic. Alexander the Great, part one. Let's go.
Ancient Greece. From around 500 BC, this rugged land was the scene of remarkable developments.
Dang.
In art, philosophy, and warfare. Its two greatest city-states were Athens, a naval power where democracy, art, drama, and philosophy flourished. And Sparta, an austere, militaristic society. Famed for its formidable army.
Where are the 300 when you need them? Just saying, you know.
In 480 BC, these two city-states had joined forces to fight an invasion by the mighty Persian Empire.
Holy shit!
At the narrow pass of Thermopylae, a small Greek force led by 300 Spartans held up the enormous Persian army for 3 days.
The 300! Yes!
Before they were finally encircled and killed.
Oh, man.
Then, in the strict...
But in the movie, they showed it like a bunch of arrows fallen like rain on them, and Leonidas died there. But they were surrounded and killed, and they stood their ground. It's fucking Spartans. Fantastic. So badass. Love it.
Rates of Salamis, the Greek fleet defeated the Persian navy.
Oh man, look at the ships. So big.
But they couldn't prevent the Persians burning the sacred temples of the Athenian Acropolis.
Oh man. The anger, the rage.
The next year at Plataea, the Greeks won a decisive land battle against the Persians. Forced them to abandon their invasion. The next 50 years were the golden age of classical Greece. But rising tension between Athens and Sparta and their allies eventually led to war, dragging the Greek world into decades of destructive fighting.
Why can't you live together? Come on, man. I know it's a Abrahamic religion and whatnot. Is that Christianity that was thriving then back? You know, if that's Christianity, I'm not surprised. It's Abrahamic religion. And you will have, people fighting, tribalistic, all of that shit. It's just insane, okay? But whatever, okay?
Wars between the Greek city-states continued for almost a century, leaving them exhausted and vulnerable to a new rising power to the north. For centuries, sophisticated Greeks had viewed the mountainous kingdom of Macedonia as a backwater. Barely Greek at all. But under King Philip II, Macedonia emerged as a formidable military force. His most famous reform...
That's such a big, vast land, and it's military, completely filled with military? Holy shit, they're going to be so dangerous. And even if you're inexperienced in the art of battle or whatever, you still... It's going to be a lot of, like, a big-ass army, and they will automatically win no matter what battle they go in. Holy shit.
Introduction of the Sarissa, an 18-foot pike, twice the length of a normal Greek spear, and wielded by trained infantry, fighting in close formation, known as a phalanx.
Phalanx. Dang. Like the finger?
In 338 BC, at the Battle of Chaeronea, Philip's army crushed the joint forces of Thebes and Athens.
Thebes. Dang!
Through alliance and conquest, Philip had already gained control over most of his neighbors.
Dang!
Now, following this victory, he united all Greece in an alliance known as the Hellenic League.
Dang!
The League of Corinth.
But history says that the Athenians won in the end, right? When was that? When did that happen? Like, obviously after this, all of this and more things. But, you know, can somebody tell me when and how did it happen? Maybe in this series we'll find out as we continue to watch every single video, okay? But cool. I love this. The Sparta-Athens, you know, rivalry, and then fucking big-ass Macedonia army almost taking over and making things... Yeah, some third party has to invade and cool things down. Like when both of your best friends are fighting, you go in and stop them, right? That's how you spread peace and all of that. You know, it's so cool. It's weird, but, you know, it's just life. It sucks, okay? But whatever. Let's go.
With Philip as hegemon, or supreme commander.
Supreme commander.
Only Sparta stood aside.
Okay.
Philip began to plan...
You can't say anything to the Spartans. Otherwise, they get pissed off. They'll not stop fucking hacking you to pieces. Basically. leave them alone. They're fine as long as they don't cause trouble. Okay. I guess that's that's why they left the Sparta alone, you know.
A great campaign.
All right.
A pan-Hellenic or all-Greek war against the Persian Empire. Their old foe was now an ailing superpower.
Superpower.
Its great riches ripe for the taking.
Whoa.
But on the eve of launching his war, Philip was assassinated by his own bodyguard.
Why?
Victim of Macedonia's brutal court rivalries.
Oh my god. That's terrible.
He was succeeded by his 20-year-old son, Alexander.
So this is how he comes in. Holy shit. You cut the head of the snake. The snake's children are waiting. It's a whole army, okay? It's like that when Alexander came in, I guess. Holy shit.
Tutored by the great philosopher Aristotle.
Hmm.
And already an experienced military commander.
Alexander
inherited his father's grand plan to invade Persia. But first he had to secure his own position as king. At home he had potential rivals executed, then crushed rebellions in Illyria, Thessaly, and central Greece. He made a special example of Thebes, completely destroying the ancient city and selling its people into slavery.
Holy shit!
In the spring of 338...
Hey, yeah, you can't expect the historical legends to be all peaceful, you know, people-loving angels or anything. It's not gonna be like that. You know, it's a form of changing during those times. And, you know, things happen, you know, you gotta... You know, what did they set out to do? And what did they achieve is what matters. You know, everybody's a piece of shit, okay? Yeah, they have to be at some point, okay? But whatever, what can we do? But let's go.
334 BC, now ready to launch his war against the Persian Empire, Alexander led his army across the Hellespont into Asia Minor.
Let's go, bitch!
It was the start of one of the greatest military campaigns in history.
Okay. Take over all of Persia, motherfucker! Let's go, Macedonian army! Yeah! Motherfucker!
Alexander's army was about 40,000 strong, drawn from all parts of Greece. The infantry were commanded by the veteran Macedonian general Parmenion. In the front rank, 9,000 Macedonian phalangites, armed with the 18-foot sarissa. These were professional soldiers,
9,000!
Well-trained and drilled, who formed up for battle in the phalanx, 16 ranks deep.
Dang!
This packed formation presented a solid wall of iron spear tips.
Holy
shit. It
was
virtually unstoppable.
Yeah. And nothing can pierce them. They have the piercers. All of them throughout the whole fucking army. They're all sticking out. And it's like almost like a porcupine. That animal, that porcupine thing with the hair is all fucking thorns. You know, it's like that. Holy shit.
But it was Dude. Also difficult to maneuver and highly vulnerable to attacks on its flanks.
Okay.
So 3,000 elite infantry, the Hypaspists, or shield bearers, armed with shorter spears, guarded its flanks. They were commanded by Parmenion's son, Nicanor. Huh.
Nicanor.
The second line of Alexander's army was made up of 7,000 Greek allies and 5,000 mercenaries, armed as hoplites. They took their name from the hoplon, their large round shield, and carried shorter 8-foot spears.
Wow. 8-foot spears. And how are you going to hold on to an 8-foot spear? That thing is like, you know, falling off of your hands. It's curving at the edge. You know, it's heavy as shit. And how are you going to even fight with that? Unless the spear itself is very light and you can move it easily, you know. But still, like, it's you need, like, really muscular strength to manipulate, you know, move it properly and stab enemies and shit, you know. You have to be a master at it. But, you know, I always felt like human body is not made to hold on to, like, you know, big ass sticks and, you know, moving them fast, you know, especially in intense situations. I don't think, you know, human body is made for that. But back then there was nothing else other than this. And, you know, there were like, you know, they were developing, they were growing. And this was one of the ways to effectively kill, I guess. So great. 8-foot spears. Good job. Okay, let's go.
Lynx was not as effective as the Macedonian phalangites, but still well armed and heavily armored for the time.
All right.
The Agrianes were the army's elite skirmishers, expert javelin throwers from what's now southern Bulgaria. Other skirmishers from Thrace and Illyria were armed with javelins, slings, and bows.
Okay.
The shock troops of Alexander's army were the Companion Cavalry. 1,800 elite horsemen.
That's a lot of
spear
people.
And sword. Commanded by Philotas, another son of Parmenion. Yeah.
This army will definitely take over things. This army will definitely defeat its enemies already. Look at this. You got 6,000 Thracians or whatever, 12,000 Greek hoplites, 3,000 Hypaspists, and, you know, crazy amount of people. It's 9,000 phalangites. It's like, that's crazy. You know, this army is meant to win, and it will win. It's a tough, extremely tough challenge for the enemies, though. I don't know if they will survive this. This is a hell approaching with demons. This is fucked up.
Dang. Alexander led the royal squadron in person. There were also 1,800 cavalry from Thessaly, commanded by Callas.
More and more and more.
600 from other parts of Greece, led by Erigeus.
It's a, it's a never-ending landscape of your enemies, and they're coming, they're marching slowly right at, they're not even concerned about you, they're just marching slowly at you, they're taking their own time, when they get to you, you're fucking dead, so, holy shit, look at this, how many people, that's insane.
Mounted scouts from Thrace and Paeonia, under Cassander.
Huh. There's so many people that the video quality is all glitching out. Low quality and Granicus. What is that?
The great Persian Empire was divided into provinces called satrapies. Each satrapy was ruled by a governor or satrap.
Okay.
Those in Asia Minor, now threatened by Alexander's invasion, met to discuss strategy.
Hmm.
Memnon of Rhodes, a skilled Greek general in Persian service, urged them to avoid battle with Alexander.
Okay.
Instead, he advised them to use a scorched earth strategy to burn villages and crops and withdraw to the interior.
Huh.
Alexander's army, he promised, would quickly starve.
Oh, that's actually a fucking brilliant idea. The only way to kill your enemy is to make him unlivable. Just cease to exist. Fantastic idea. Just kill all the things that can provide him food and let him starve. You know, whatever food he has, he'll eat that and live and, you know, just let him, just isolate him and he will kill himself. Holy shit. This is evil as fuck. Man. Wow, such evil people back then. Holy shit.
It was good advice, but the satraps were unwilling to lay waste to their own provinces without a fight.
Huh.
So they decided to face Alexander's army.
No!
At the river Granicus.
That's crazy, man. You're gonna die. This is literally Napoleon 2.0, man. This Alexander guy must be even more powerful than Napoleon. From what I'm seeing so far, he sounds like he's a fucking Godzilla coming to eat a small village. That's how it is. Holy shit.
The Persian army formed up behind the river, which was shallow but 60 feet wide with steep banks.
Okay.
Their front line was a wall of cavalry, about 10,000 horsemen from across the empire.
Dang, son.
Medes and Hyrcanians from modern Iran, Bactrians from Afghanistan, and Paphlagonians from Turkey's Black Sea coast.
10,000 troops. That's Persians.
Behind, in reserve, were the infantry, several thousand Greek mercenaries,
a common sight
in Persian armies at this time.
Dang.
These men fought for Persian gold, and were armed with the round shield and short spear of hoplites.
Dang.
The Persians may have been unsure if they could trust these men in combat against fellow Greeks, and
Man.
So placed them at the rear.
I'm assuming like they probably saw a lot of blood throughout their military careers. They probably saw a lot of gore, a lot of flesh, and a lot of hacking. It's like, imagine yourself holding a knife trying to attack, I don't know, think like attacking a thief entering, breaking into your house, and you have a knife and you gotta defend yourself or something in that situation. Imagine like even slashing that person. It's almost impossible to do because you're like, I never hurt anybody, you know? So it's like, to even do that, it's like you're amateur, you don't even know, but these motherfuckers have been hacking hacking enemies, their enemies, throughout their whole lives at this point. And they probably cut off arms, flesh, blood, and it's just mayhem everywhere. They probably walked through a land of dead bodies and shit like that, rotting dead bodies too. Oh my God, these people must be so experienced, man. Just, they're scary. I mean, that much army, you have a lot of crazy people in there. And it is scary as fuck. Don't let them, you know, become your enemies. They will fucking eat you alive. They won't even, like, you know, fry you or anything. They're just gonna eat you raw. Just fucking hell. Dang.
Alexander, determined to attack and destroy this Persian force before it could retreat, raced to the Granicus with his best troops. On his left wing, he posted Thessalian, Greek, and Thracian cavalry under Parmenion's command.
Okay. The Persians are not a joke.
In the center were
Let's
the
see what Alexander
spears
got.
Of the phalanx. Its six divisions commanded by Perdiccas, Koinos, Amyntas, Philip, Meleager, and Craterus.
Dang.
On the right, Alexander himself with the companion cavalry under Philotas, as well as the elite hypaspists, the Agrianes javelin throwers, and the archers.
Dang.
Alexander, with 13,000 infantry and 5,000 cavalry in all, was probably slightly outnumbered. But ignoring advice to wait until dawn to cross the river, he ordered an immediate assault.
Might as well do it. Why wait to, you know, it's almost like you're awaiting failure. Let's just fucking go. Let's just get this done with, you know. It's much better to catch the enemy at his weakest point, weakest timing of the day, than, you know, preparing for a proper battle and let your enemy have the chance of winning and shit like that. No, just go, fucking go and fucking start hacking. You're used to it anyway. Let's just go it.
Sent a squadron of companion cavalry to ford the river, followed by a regiment of hypaspists and the Paeonian light cavalry.
Oh man.
Alexander, calling on his men starting to show from one their corner. Courage, then led his right wing across the river.
Let's go, let's fucking... No humanity left, let's fucking hack everybody into pieces.
As they reached the middle of the river, the Greeks came under a hail of javelins, darts and arrows from the Persian line.
Oh my god! Fuck!
Those that made it to the far bank were immediately charged by the Persian cavalry.
Oh my god! Shit! Careful, careful! Oh my god! I like this
Alexander
game footage!
Was in the thick of the fighting.
Oh, okay. Be careful, Alexander!
He attacked where the whole mass of their cavalry and leaders were stationed. Around him, a desperate conflict raged.
Oh my god!
Horses were jammed against horses,
and men
against men.
Oh.
The Macedonians striving...
Some horses must have been fucking stabbed and, you know, just left to die bleeding. You know, it's a mess. It's a pointy, speary, metal-bladey mess. Holy shit.
To drive the Persians away from the riverbank. The Persians determined to prevent them crossing and to push them back into the river.
Oh, man. Oh. Yeah, pushing them back to the river. Whoever crosses the river is in disadvantage, in my opinion. What are you gonna do there? You know, you're at the banks and they have the high ground. Just fucking, they're gonna push you back into the river, easily fucking defeating you. You know, I don't know about that. You know, so if there's a river on, and you're on the both sides, you might as well stand on opposite sides and start shooting arrows. Much better way to combat than try to cross the river. And it's also like, have you been into like ponds and rivers and shit? The mud in there is so like almost like quicksand, and your leg just goes lower and lower into the sand. Underwater, it's just all fucking muddy and fucked up, man. You cannot cross a fucking river. If it's just a pond, maybe, but fucking river, I don't think you can. This is a bad place to fight. Why is there a river in the middle? It's just dangerous. I don't think, and you will probably die if you go on the other side. It's just not good, you know?
Alexander's attack seemed reckless, but he was buying time for the rest of his army to cross the river.
Okay.
Including the irresistible Macedonian phalanx.
Okay, okay. Cool.
Then, suddenly, Alexander was fighting for his life, charged by two Persian nobles.
Oh my god! No, please.
Rhoesacis rode up to Alexander and struck him on the head with his sword, breaking off a piece of his helmet.
No!
But the helmet broke the force of the blow, and Alexander struck him down with his lance.
Oh my god!
Then, from behind, Spithridates raised his sword against the king, but Black Clytus, son of Dropidas, anticipated his blow, struck his arm, and cut it off, sword and all.
Oh my god! Oh god, imagine getting your arm cut off, because these are like thick metals, sharp blades, meant to kill you, and your arm, oh my god, imagine cutting off your arm, bro. And it probably cuts off so easily because the metal is so thick and strong and sharp. Holy shit. And how are you gonna... Now you're gonna regret your whole life because you don't have an arm. Holy shit. I wonder how you lived after that. Dang, man. And, you know... And also, like, if you're on the opposite sides of the river, and you're both of you are charging to fight each other, you know, just go slower so the enemies can come, you know, get into the river and just make them lure them on your side through the river. And as soon as they get to the banks, fucking start beating, you know, hacking and shit. Maybe that's a good strategy, you know. But yeah, and also like this guy, I wonder how he survived. Man. Dang.
Now the Greek army was across the river, and the Persian cavalry faced a wall of Macedonian spears. Most turned and fled.
Oh, man!
The speed and shock of Alexander's attack meant Persia's Greek mercenaries hadn't even had time to join the battle.
Huh.
Alexander, in a blood rage, or possibly regarding these Greeks as traitors, ignored their appeals for mercy.
Oh, jeez! I don't know about that!
The mercenaries were surrounded on all sides, and massacred.
Oh my god! Dead body feels! Holy shit! Oh my god!
Alexander had won a great victory.
Okay, he won!
Asia Minor now lay at his mercy. But the Persian Empire was still a land of immense wealth and power.
Yeah, that's a lot of land to cover too. Like, you know, when Napoleon tried to invade Russia, you know, they were always, the Russians were always, you know, running around, you know, they were never he never had the chance to invade because it's a vast land and, you know, he has to take over like small castles and shit. It just doesn't work, you know, it never works. And they will always be planning to retake it, and it's a hellish situation. So I don't know how Alexander is going to take over this whole, invade the whole thing. I don't know.
It was mobilizing its vast resources to face him.
Oh!
If Alexander was to conquer this empire and take his place in history, he'd next have to face Darius, King of Kings himself.
Holy shit! Fuck! Oh my god!
Research and artwork for this video comes from Osprey Publishing's extensive range of books on ancient history. Every Osprey book examines a particular battle, campaign, or combat unit in authoritative, meticulous detail. And with more than 3,000 titles, they cover everything from ancient warfare to modern conflict. Visit their
cool
website
stuff
to see their online catalogue. Huge thanks
Man.
To the YouTube channel Invicta for their help in making this series.
Okay.
You can find out more about
the
remarkable
pay him on
life
Patreon.
Of Alexander the Great in their
go
Moments
pay him on
in
Patreon.
History series.
Fantastic series.
If you'd
series.
Like to help us make more history videos, please visit our Patreon page.
Okay. I'm going to stop it because the next part is going to start. But dang, son, what a great series. And also, like, I feel like I'm running out of content from Epic History TV. I feel like there's nothing else. You know, what else is there? Suez Crisis, Islamic stuff. There's another series there. And Apollo Mission series. You know, just a few more left. You know, I feel like history is very less compared to the content of Epic History TV, you know. it's ridiculous. But Alexander the Great Part 1, crazy. And, you know, bloodthirsty rage in the end. He went in and ignored the traitors and went in and won the battle. The traitors got killed. Holy shit. You know, he's crazy. Bit more crazier than Napoleon. I would say Napoleon is like more like strategic, you know, calm, collected dude. But I feel like Alexander the Great is more like his status and the power that he can command and the charge from his massive army. He's more powerful compared to Napoleon, who is more strategically powerful. You know what I mean? So. Great stuff, and politically more powerful. That's what Napoleon is all about, politics and strategy. But I feel like Alexander is more like, you know, manhood and how powerful, like an alpha male, fucking fucking crazy alpha male, okay? So, yeah, it's almost like Vikings or berserkers, you know, it's like that. But, you know, I could be wrong. Please tell me what kind of person Alexander personally, like his personality, how is he? What is he like? Please tell me in the comment section. And sorry for the lack of uploads. It's because I even mentioned that I was going to do videos every day, but I got a copyright strike on my backup channel again after just about 2 days of, you know, peace and freedom from a copyright strike. They give me another one. It's like I don't even want to do reactions, you know. I just don't have any, you know, interest to do anything anymore. It's just, I'm just sick of YouTube. I hate YouTube. It's not like I'm super tired and I don't want it. I am tired and I don't want to do it, but you know, it's YouTube that's turning me off. YouTube is turning me off so badly that I just don't want to even think about YouTube, let alone do reactions. But there's a Death Battle video coming out tonight, and a Meat Cannon video already is out there, and I just did a reaction to it. So I'm going to make a mashup on that, and a Death Battle video mashup will be coming tomorrow. So yeah, cool stuff. I hope you really enjoyed this new series, Alexander the Great. Sorry if I don't understand some things. I'm not European. I'm not American. I'm just some guy from India, okay? So please try to understand. Please tell me if I don't know anything. Please educate me or something in the comment section. I will definitely read it. Please don't get angry or offended if I said anything about, I don't know, politics. And I'm also very critical of the Western society, so I'm sorry about that. But, you know, I just, you know, I have some opinions that are like anti-Western, you know. I guess it comes because I'm like from other part of the world and not exactly American. So whatever. Okay, Alexander the Great Part 1 by Epic History TV. How did you like this reaction? Did you like this reaction? If you like this reaction, please subscribe to this channel if you like this reaction. And also, like, go check out my backup channel. All the Napoleon videos are over there. Don't expect me to upload there because I got another copyright strike because YouTube decided to fucking, hey man, just fucking destroy this motherfucker. That's what YouTube thinks, you know. It's almost like that, you know. So go check it out. The links are all in the description. And go check out my reaction mashup channel. New reaction mashups are going to come in. So go check it out. And yeah, that's it for this reaction, okay? Convert for part 2 will be uploading next week. The same day today, but I'm going to be uploading. Don't worry if I'm not uploading too many, okay? You know, not every day, but I only upload once a week, but I upload shitload of videos so that you'll be covered for the rest of the week, okay? So please subscribe to both my channels, my mashup channel as well, and I'll see you guys in the next part 2. Can't wait to see part 2. I love this, okay? So please subscribe to both my channels, and I'll see you guys later. Goodbye.